Hi everyone, good evening or good morning, whichever part of the world you are joining us from, and we'll just give a minute or two before we get started. In the meantime, we would love to know, where is everyone joining us from, and if you are you waitlisted, or and if you are, at which school. We'll give it a minute. Great, we have someone from Chicago. Well, welcome. All right, I think in the interest of time, we are going to get started because we have a lot of ground to cover, okay? I'm just going to make, the introductions and, a few opening slides, and then I'm going to hand it over to my colleague, Anju Goela from the Redpen MBA team. To basically walk us through, what are some of the strategies that you can use if you are waitlisted at business school, okay? Just before we get started, I will repeat this, and Anju will also repeat this, that do know, if you're watching this not live, but, a recording, or whenever you're watching this, do know that, if you are waitlisted, there are things that you have to do to get off the waitlist. It's not a passive game. You just don't have to wait around and provide passive updates to the business school. But it's an active strategy or multiple strategies that you need to deploy to get it off. Anju is an expert on our team. She's our go-to person, and she has worked with many, many, many of our applicants whom we have successfully converted at Harvard Business School, MIT, Wharton, Michigan Ross, and so on and so forth. So we just get started. I'll just run everyone through a few couple of slides, and then I'm going to hand it over to Anju. Just an introduction, we at the team MBA at the Redpen, we are a global team with international admissions consulting experience. We are a team of folks who have got our MBAs from top business schools, and we have worked with thousands of applicants who have made it to their dream schools, some of which are the M7 schools, the S10 schools, or LBS, INSEAD, HEC in Europe. These are some of our results from 2021-22. And the next slide as well is our result from, from the year before that. Pretty consistent. We primarily work with applicants around the world, helping them on the MBA admissions to top 25-30 global business schools. All right. Okay, all right, now I'm going to hand over to Anju, and I will join everyone back in the Q&A session. I do encourage everyone, please keep posting on questions in the comment box, and we will take all questions at the end of the session. Over to you, Anju. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Good evening, good morning, depending on which part of the world you're joining us from. So round one applications have been submitted and interview invites are rolling in. For those of you who applied in the early rounds, or you applied to schools that offer a guaranteed interview, or if you've applied to schools which accept applications on a rolling basis, you might have appeared for your interview and you might have heard back from them. So to those of you who've been accepted by a business school, congratulations to you. For those of you who didn't make it, I'm sure you applied to other schools or you will be applying to schools in round two. Good luck with the applications and the outcomes. But there may be some of you who've been waitlisted. Now, the waitlist is a gray area. It causes a lot of anxiety amongst applicants. You haven't been accepted by a school. At the same time, you haven't been rejected by a school. You feel kind of suspended somewhere in between. So today we are going to talk about what it means to be on the waitlist and the steps that you can take to try get off that waitlist. let's start with what it means to be on the wait list. So remember that wait list is not a rejection. It just means that your application is still under consideration. The AdCom is genuinely interested in your candidature and sees you as a viable addition to the class, but it probably needs a little more time and information to take a decision on your application. There are various types of waitlists. You could be waitlisted after an interview or without an interview. The waitlist can be an open waitlist or a closed waitlist. I'm going to discuss this going forward. The question that most candidates have on their minds when they're waitlisted is, did I do something wrong? Why did I not make it to the school? The short answer is no. The problem sometimes is that there are, you know, a lot of good candidates and not enough spots. It's basically a numbers game. And then, of course, there are additional considerations. You know, the AdCom needs to shape and balance the class in terms of diversity, gender, and profession, nationality. So they need to take tough decisions. They have to be selective, you know, while shaping the class. I know all of you who've been waitlisted are thinking, what are my chances of getting off the waitlist? Or can I even get off the waitlist? So while there are no guarantees that you will get off the waitlist, you still stand a chance. As I mentioned earlier, your application is still under active consideration. So you need to stay cautiously optimistic. You need to use the time between the communication of the waitlist and the final outcome very wisely. Start building on your profile, providing updates to AdCom, demonstrating continued interest in the school where you're waitlisted, all of which can work in your favor. Now, of course, if the school has a high yield rate or if the program is really small, getting off the waitlist may be tough. Also, if you've applied in round three, chances are a little slim, you know, primarily because you know, there are very limited spots available by the time. So what should you do? Should you just sit back and wait for the AdCom to get back to you? The simple answer is no. You need to be proactive. The first thing that you need to do is confirm your place on the waitlist. You need to decide, are you still interested in staying on the waitlist or are you willing to accept another admit? If the school where you've been waitlisted is your first choice, you need to communicate your continued interest and confirm your place on the waitlist. Most schools have a specified timeline within which you need to confirm your place on the waitlist. So please adhere to that. Schools also have different modes of communicating the confirmation. Please follow the specified format and the mode of communication. You could be asked to communicate your waitlist through the school website, through the admissions portal, through the waitlist form, or through an email. What you essentially need to do is follow the individual process set down by each school. Each school has a very different waitlist process. You need to review and observe the guidelines very carefully. Now, there are some schools which only want to know if you would like to remain on their wait list. They do not want any further communication from you. They do not want any further updates or documents from you. Now, this is what we call a closed wait list. Now, there are some schools which are open to receiving additional information and updates, and they will let you know how you should be doing that. And these are open wait lists. There are a very, very few schools which offer you suggestions to strengthen your candidacy. So you need to reach out to the AdCom or the person assigned to you and get feedback on your candidature and how you can improve it to try get off the wait list. Sometimes what schools also do is reach out to waitlisted candidates to figure out your intent. Now, if they're really keen on a certain candidate, they may just pick up the phone and call you and ask you if you will accept a spot if offered one. Basically, they're trying to protect their yield. They don't want to offer you a spot if you have already accepted another admit or if you're no longer interested in it. So if you get a call like that, please confirm immediately. You also need to review information that the school provides through their waitlist webinars, chats, and FAQs on the website to understand the requirements of each individual school. Now, there is one more thing that you should do, which most candidates are not aware of or do not bother doing, which is to update the alumni or current student interviewer about their waitlist status. If you've been interviewed by an alumni or a current student, please let them know that you've been waitlisted at the school. Ask them for suggestions and feedback, and sometimes they do come back with very valuable feedback on your interview and, you know, about how you are a good or not a good fit for the school. And this will help you kind of, you know, work towards your and bridge the gap and work towards your weaknesses. I'm just going to quickly walk you through some school-specific processes. Schools like Kellogg, Duke, Fuqua, and Haas have waitlist webinars where they specify what they want and the next steps in the process. There are a very few schools like Tuck and Darden, which give you feedback on your application and the candidature and ways in which you can improve your candidature. Schools like Fuqua, Cornell, and Darden accept additional letters of recommendation. There are other schools like Kellogg, which will not accept any additional LORs. Most schools accept updates, but the formats may differ. So you have to be mindful. And as I said, you know, go through the various resources that they have to figure out the format that they want you to submit the updates in. I'll just quickly talk about, you know, the processes that certain schools follow. For instance, Harvard Business School specifies the timeline and the format for updates. So please do not jump the gun and start sending updates the moment you get a waitlist. Columbia Business School, you know, you can send your first set of updates along with your acceptance of the waitlist. At Kellogg, you know, the waitlist, the updates are accepted to the waitlist update form. And they also accept additional application documents like a new GMAT score or an updated resume through the application status page. Duke Fuqua accepts updates to the waitlist application form. At Haas, if you've been waitlisted without an interview, once you accept your spot on the waitlist, you will be asked to take the video interview. At Booth, you are required to answer a video essay. You'll be given 3 questions and be asked to answer 1 question. They also welcome updates. Tuck is one of those schools which offers feedback to strengthen your candidacy. They also accept updates through the waitlist update portal. They're also a unique school in the sense that they might even re-interview you. But this is going to be initiated by the school and not you. You cannot ask for to be re-interviewed. If they are interested in you and they want to know a little more about you, they might come back to you and re-interview you. Johnson asks waitlisted candidates to submit an action plan that identifies their areas of improvement and the steps that they are planning to take to address the same. The admissions committee expects you to send regular updates on the submitted action plan. At Darden, a member of the admissions committee will have a one-on-one interaction with waitlisted candidates where candidates can give updates and receive feedback on their application and their candidature. They also accept update letters and letters of support. McDonough requires you to submit a 150-word waitlist essay. At London Business School, again, you can set up an appointment with the recruitment admissions manager who will help you explore your profile in more detail and answer questions on the waitlist. So now that we've spoken about what it means to be on the waitlist, let's talk about steps that you can take to strengthen your application and your candidature. So the first thing that you do is to self-assess your profile. Some schools, as I've mentioned earlier, provide feedback, but most schools do not. So you need to assess your profile on your own and identify and address the areas of weaknesses. For instance, if you have a low GMAT, GRE, or an EA score, you can retake the standardized test if it is below the school average. If you've maxed out on the test effort, then you know you could take courses and certifications to demonstrate the effort to build your quant skills to be able to take on the academic rigor of an MBA program. So there are various courses that you can take. You can do the MBA maths. You can take, there are courses on Coursera. There is the HBX score, but that requires a lot of time commitment. So you need to figure out if you have that kind of time. There are also graded courses, you know, by UCLA Anderson and Berkeley Haas. These are extension courses. They are fairly rigorous, and you'll be able to demonstrate your quant abilities through these courses. If you feel that you have weak English language skills, you can take the TOEFL and, you know, submit your score. If you've already submitted a score and it is not very good, you can retake the TOEFL and you know, demonstrate your English language proficiency. If you feel that your application is not able to demonstrate your leadership and initiative, this is an area that needs to be addressed. All schools across the board look for leadership in their candidates. So what you can do after, you know, between the time when you receive the waitlist decision and the final outcome, you can take on leadership roles both within and outside the organization. You can lead projects and initiatives independently. There are various ways of showing leadership. Leadership is not just about leading teams and projects. You can also showcase leadership through mentorship, through empowering others, through conflict resolution and problem solving. Other things that you can do is undertake more complex tasks and assignments, take on professional challenges, demonstrated interest. Now, this is you know, this is something that a lot of students or applicants tend to ignore, but it is a very important part both of the application process and once you get waitlisted. So continue to engage with the school even after submitting the application. You know, attend webinars, events, talk to current students, alums, attend coffee chats. It is very important to demonstrate interest besides stating it. You know, I always quote what LBS says, we want students who want us. So it's very important to tell them that, you know, I want to come to your school. I'm very passionate about your school. I've continued to engage with the school even after having submitted the application. There are certifications that you can do for, you know, relevant to your professional growth. I'm going to just quickly answer certain questions around retaking the GMAT and, you know, taking certain courses. Candidates come to me and ask me, if I have a high GMAT or a GRE score, do I need to do additional courses or certifications? Now, if the GMAT score is high, there is no need to focus on extra courses. You only need to do these courses or certifications if you're trying to offset a low GPA or a GMAT, or if they further your professional knowledge or growth. The other question that I'm asked very often is, if I have a GMAT waiver for the application, should I take the GMAT? Will a better GMAT score ensure conversion of a waitlist? A GMAT waiver is normally given if you've already shown or demonstrated quantitative proficiency, or if you were unable to take the GMAT due to certain extenuating circumstances like the COVID-19 lockdowns. Now, if you can get a score, it might help you in the second case. Or if you are from an overrepresented pool or have a lower GPA, you know, getting a score could help you, which is above the average of the school, may help your candidature. Otherwise, admissions is a, you know, the admission process is holistic, and the GMAT itself cannot get you into a school. So what documents should you send to the school if you've been waitlisted? Now remember, this will depend from school to school and what the school is ready to accept. So there are three kinds of documents that can be submitted to schools. Again, as I said, depending on what they are willing to accept. You can send updates through email, through the waitlist update form, through essays, or any other school-specified format. You can send additional letters of recommendation, and you can submit a letter of support. What kind of updates should you send to the school? What we essentially need to address is what is it that has changed since you applied? So there are different kind of updates that you can send to the school. You can send material updates, which essentially means, you know, any data points like a new GMAT, GRE, or an EA score. If you've had any professional achievements since submitting the application, a promotion, a new role, any additional responsibilities, any awards or commendations. If you've done a significant project or assignment or completed something that you had started, when you submitted the application, you can, you know, mention those and submit those. You need to also, while you are talking about significant projects and assignments, you need to highlight skills that speak to the ethos of the school. You can give updates on extracurricular and co-curricular activities if you have, taken up any volunteering project, or if you've accomplished a project that you'd started, you know, while you were applying. You need to focus on the impact that you've created, and if you've led those projects, try and highlight your leadership skills. If you've done any courses or certifications recently to upskill yourself in your area, in your professional area of interest, you can mention those. Once again, and I cannot reiterate this enough, you need to demonstrate your interest. So what you can mention in your updates is the engagement that you've had with the school through their webinars, events, information sessions, your connect with current students, alums, clubs, interest groups. But please do not give a laundry list of all the events that you've attended and all the alums or current students that you've spoken to. That really isn't going to add value. What you need to do is mention how you've derived certain insights from these engagements and how these insights have convinced you about the school being the right fit for you. You can also reiterate your commitment to the school and that it is your first choice. And if you're sure that that is the school that you want to go to, please let them know that you will accept a spot if offered one. Certain questions around updates. When should you send the update? Well, some schools specify the timeline, as I mentioned earlier. If the timeline is not specified, material updates like a new GMAT, GRE score, a promotion, a new role or responsibility can be sent immediately. Other updates can be clubbed together and sent once every few weeks. For schools with rolling admissions, updates should be sent at the earliest. How frequently should you send the updates? Every 4 to 6 weeks. I mean, you need to have something meaningful to send, and I feel that you need 4 to 6 weeks to, do something or create an impact. Please do not send updates every week or too frequently. It can go against you. How do you send the update? Some schools have a specific format and a mode of communication. If that has not been specified, you can send it over in an email to the ATCOM. The second document that you can send is a letter of recommendation. Some schools allow for an additional letter of recommendation. Darden allows for multiple letters of recommendation. Please remember that the LOR should be additive. It needs to provide a new perspective. Try and get it from a person who's not already given you a recommendation, which is a part of the application. avoid repetition of instances and projects that you've mentioned in the previous LORs. Every document that you submit should add value to your application, which is why I said, you know, it should provide a new perspective and should be given from, you know, a new recommender. The letter of support. This is the third component. And this is something that, again, a lot of candidates ignore and do not, maybe they do not think about it or know about it, but it can really, you know, help strengthen your candidature. Let me talk about the difference. Before I get into the letter of support, let me talk about the difference between a recommendation letter and a letter of support. So a letter of recommendation is usually a part of the application process. Of course, there are some schools which accept additional recommendations if you're waitlisted. But the letter of recommendation is written by your superior or your senior at work who has an overview of your work and your career trajectory. He or she essentially talks about what you've done and achieved in a particular role and highlights certain specific skills and strengths. Okay. Now, the letter of support can be written by anyone who knows you, an alum or a current student, or even the faculty from a particular school. This person, the endorser, doesn't have to be your supervisor at work. He or she can be anyone who knows you really well. The purpose of the letter of support is very different from a letter of recommendation. The letter of support primarily demonstrates your fit for a particular school. Now, the alum or a current student is in a unique position because they know the school really well, and they understand the school, and they know you well. So they can demonstrate how you will make, you know, a good addition to the cohort, you will make a good fit for the school. And you know how focused MBA programs are on candidates being a good fit for their program. So this is what a letter of support does primarily. How long should the letter of support be? Not more than a page, 500 words. How many letters of support should you submit? Focus on quality and not quantity. One good letter of support is enough. It's hard enough to find one alum or current student from each of the schools that you apply to. So if you know somebody who with whom you've developed a very good rapport or whom you know very well, try and get a letter of support, a strong letter of support from them. A lot of candidates come to us and say, we've got somebody who is ready to endorse us, but they do not know what to write. Now, there are schools like Booth which have a shape the class format, okay, where they ask the alum, current student, or the or a faculty member who's endorsing the candidate very specific questions. But most other schools do not have a format. So I'm going to walk you through a suggested framework. And this is what you can ask, you know, the person who's endorsing you to follow for the letter of support to be impactful and, of course, have, you know, a structure. The endorser can start by introducing himself or herself and give the context of his or her relationship with you. Then he needs to go on to demonstrate your fit for the school, highlighting how you are aligned to the ethos of the school. He can mention what is it that you will bring to the school and the community and how you will be a good addition to the school, both within and outside the classroom. He can also talk about how the school is uniquely positioned to help you achieve your goals, and then finally endorse your candidature and mention that he or she is open to any questions from the admissions committee. There is one thing that I'd like to mention here. The letter of support needs to come from a place of personal experience. Okay? The endorser needs to connect what he's experienced at the school to something that resonates with you and, you know, something that will make you a good fit for the school. For instance, if he or she is talking about, you know, how the school is positioned to help you achieve your goals. Now, they cannot pick what you've mentioned, you know, in your why a particular school essay and say, okay, they can leverage these XYZ resources and this is what they can do to achieve their goals. What they essentially need to talk about is maybe they followed a similar path and they have similar goals. They can mention that, you know, they followed this path and these are the very specific resources that they have leveraged at the school. They are part of certain clubs. They've attended certain events. They've met certain industry experts. They've done certain internships, which is which is kind of helping them move towards their goal. Or if they don't have a similar path that you're taking, they can even talk about, you know, their colleagues or other people in the cohort who are taking a similar path. So as I said, it has to come from a place of personal experience. Okay. They can't put a laundry list of classes that you can take and, you know, clubs that you can join. There has to be a certain level of specificity. Certain do's and don'ts when you're waitlisted. I've already mentioned most of them, but I'm going to quickly walk you through them. Stay positive. Do not panic. You've not been rejected. But do not have an emotional response to the waitlist. I know it may be a school that you're very keen to go to. It may be your first choice, but do not respond in resentment or bitterness. Okay, demonstrate maturity. As mentioned earlier, be proactive. I always say this, silence is not golden in this situation, but being aggressive could be counterproductive. Go over your application and get a fresh perspective. Identify and bridge gaps, if any. Reflect on the interview, update the alum interviewer on the waitlist and seek feedback. Keep a plan B ready. Please do apply to other schools, you know, and, you know, have a backup plan ready. Follow individual school processes. Reach out to the May waitlist manager if you've been assigned one. Darden does that. LBS does that. So, you know, figure out if the school is assigning you a waitlist manager, reach out to them for, to know what you need to do next and if they're ready to provide any feedback on your application. Mention timelines if you've applied to other schools where offers could expire so that the school is aware that you have these other offers and, you are on the waitlist, but, you might have to take up these offers if you don't get off the waitlist by a certain time frame. Solicit feedback from the school only if it allows for it. Okay. Do not flood their mailbox with emails. Do not keep calling them up, asking them as to why you were waitlisted and asking them on feedback on your application and your candidature if the school has specifically mentioned that they are not willing to do so. Actively seek opportunities to strengthen your candidature. We've already discussed that. Only provide meaningful updates. Okay. Visit the campus if possible. Now, there's a caveat here. You're not going to get into a school only because you visited the campus. But visiting the campus helps you, understand the school, understand, the cohort, understand, the culture of the school. You may even attend certain classes. And what this is going to do is give you a better understanding of why you are a good fit for the school. And you can mention that, in one of your updates. Schools want to provide a level playing field, so they are not going to admit you only because you visited the campus. In case you have an ED acceptance or you've accepted another offer, please withdraw your application so that they can consider another person on the wait list, for a spot. In case you're rejected and the school where you've been waitlisted is your first school, is your first choice, you should definitely apply to that school in the coming year. It kind of shows commitment to the school and you definitely stand a better chance. This year, we had a candidate who was waitlisted after an interview last year and then rejected. He reapplied to that school, and he got accepted. I'm going to quickly walk you through certain FAQs. Do schools rank waitlisted candidates? No, they do not. when do schools take decisions on waitlist? Normally after the following round, but decisions can be made at any point in the cycle. Do schools evaluate waitlisted candidates only when they have spots? No, not really. Waitlist applications are reviewed on an ongoing basis. Schools are trying to build a diverse class. They generally have checkpoints which line up with admissions rounds. Waitlists are normally closed in late spring and summer. Will a campus visit help my candidature? I've already discussed that. If I'm planning to switch jobs, should I tell the adcom? Please only inform them after you've taken up a new assignment. Okay. Tell them about the job. Tell them about your responsibilities. Tell them what excites you about the job and how it is aligned to your goals. What if you have a low IR and AWA? IR lower than 5 and AWA lower than 4 normally needs to be addressed. But if you have other indications in the applications to show strong language skills, then there really is no need. Which courses and certifications should I do to improve my profile? I've already discussed that. Will taking courses in management or leadership add value to my application? No, these will not. You can do them only if they will help you professionally. So that brings us to the end of the session, and the floor is open now for Q&A.
Well, thank you so much, Anju. I think, you know, probably I think anyone who's listening to this, me for sure, I think, you know, this should be eye-opening that, you know, there's so much to do when you're waitlisted, that, you know, it's not the end of the road. We do have some questions. I believe, you know, you've already answered them, you know, during the session, but let's take them up again. There's someone saying that, you know, I'm waitlisted without interview at Scheller. What can I infer from this? So if anyone is waitlisted without an interview, what does that mean?
Well, it means that they're still interested in your application. Do reach out to them. You cannot ask for an interview unless and until they initiate the interview, but you can follow all the other steps that we've discussed in the webinar.
Okay, understood. I think that's the only question we have for waitlist, and I'm not surprised because I think this time, you know, in the application cycle, we are definitely looking at, you know, some more time before round one, you know, final decisions are out, and, you know, whether folks are waitlisted or they receive a final you know, admit or a reject. Okay, there are two more questions which have come in now. I have read online that Stern admits almost everyone on their waitlist. Is this true? And do you have any specific tips for NYU Stern?
No, definitely not. They don't admit everyone that they waitlist. That hasn't been our experience. And, you know, we've been doing this for over 11 years. They don't. We don't have those statistics. Schools don't release those statistics. They are as selective as any other school.
I agree. The other question I have, there is, if I have a high GMAT total and AWA score, but a low IR, do I need to still pull it up? We are not, you know, test prep experts, but the only thing I will tell you about GMAT and GRE is that the comparison is done region-wise. You know, if, you know, region-wise, profile-wise, which is why I think they look at the profile in totality. If you have a certain kind of profile and there's someone with the exact similar profile, then that those comparisons will matter. And when I say region wise, it would be, you know, common for Indians would be compared against Indians in the international applicant pool.
I'll just add something here, Preeti. You know, sometimes what happens is that IR is an anomaly. You may have taken several attempts and it may have just happened that, you know, this particular attempt, you've scored a high GMAT score. You've got, you know, your verbal is good, your quant is good, your AWA is good. It's just that you've slipped on your IR. But if you've not canceled your previous scores, you can add them to the application and show them that, yeah, you know, I did score a high IR and this is just an anomaly.
Agreed. One more question that we have come in is, hi, Anju, can an interviewer ask if one has applications to other schools? And can that also be a cause to be waitlisted if one admits that, yes, I have applied to other schools?
Interviewers do ask if you are if you applied to other schools. In fact, there are some schools which ask you this question in the application form as well. We always advise candidates to be truthful and to tell them, you know, the schools that you've applied to, because what also happens is if you've sent your GMAT score to, you know, multiple schools, the formal GMAT score to multiple schools, all the schools to which you've sent the GMAT score are mentioned on that form. So it's always better to be honest. Schools will not waitlist you just because you're applying to other schools. They will look at your profile in total, and if it is something that you know that they're happy with, and if it is, and if you're the kind of candidate that they want to have, they are going to offer you a spot.
Okay, awesome. Thank you. Now, I think this is one of my favorite questions, because I think 2 years in a row we have gotten, you know, in round two we have gotten one applicant each in each round of the Harvard Business School waitlist. So the question is, for HBS waitlist, what is your recommended strategy?
Right. So HBS, we've actually got someone who's got waitlisted in round one, and they have been told that the school will come back to them in another week and tell them, you know, what they're going to what they want from the candidate going forward. So you should not send anything unless and until you know, the school tells you and specifies what they want of you. And Harvard is one of the schools that does that. But at the same time, as I said, you know, try and, you know, identify your areas of weakness, work on those so that, you know, when they ask for updates, you're able to give those. Get that letter of support, from a senior industry professional who's an alum or maybe a current student or a faculty who knows you very well, is going to add value to your application. Okay. So those are the things that you need to do for HBS. And we've got, when we've had people who've got off the wait list at HBS, not once, but more than once.
Yes. In fact, last 2 years back to back, I think, you know, the year before we had one of our own applicants, and the year after that we had someone, you know, who was who had worked with someone else, but he came to us for HBS waitlist conversion, and we were able to get him off the waitlist. In fact, I would say this to everyone, you know, who's on this call: if you are waitlisted and you would like to work with us, there is a link of, you know, for booking an appointment with Redfin. Please book your appointment with us and ask specifically for Anju if you like to work with us. We do have, you know, we don't have any waitlist preparation package or something, but we do provide hourly consultations, which can be you know, useful for, and then we can contextualize, you know, what strategies can be used for your specific case, and, you know, guide you accordingly. The follow-up question to the HBS waitlist strategies is, the interviewer usually the main reason why people are waitlisted at HBS? Not exactly. We have someone who's waitlisted without an interview. He deferred directly to round two for consideration.
This is a very interesting question, and I want to add something here. You know, there are schools like LBS and INSEAD where the interview process is very intense, and the interview is the kind of the deciding factor, okay, on whether you are accepted or waitlisted. For other schools, you know, like HBS and other schools, it is one of the components, like Preeti rightly mentioned. It is not the only deciding factor for you being accepted, rejected, or waitlisted at a particular school.
Perfect. Awesome. So there are no more questions. And I would just, tell everyone that, you know, please contact us if you have, you know, questions specific to your waitlist. Don't give up. Don't, you know, just sit passive and just give mundane updates. Do know that there are applicants, you know, working very hard to get off the waitlist. So, you know, if you want to get into your dream school, do contact us, and we look forward to, you know, helping you, you know, convert the waitlist to get into your dream school. Thank you so much, Anju, for your time and all this.
Do you just want to project the last slide where we give our email ID and details of where they can contact us?
Yes, definitely. I think there was a link which was already provided by GMAT Club, but you can, you know, specific, if you need a specific email, then you can write us directly at team.mba@theredpen.in. And you can also Google us, The Red Pen, and you'll still find a book and appointment session. So, you know, we look forward to hearing from you. Well, thank you, Ritvik, as well. Thank you, everyone who joined us, and anyone who's watching a recording. You know, I hope you find this useful as well.
And feel free to reach out to us if you have any further questions or if you want help on your waitlist.
Thank you so much, everyone. Bye.
Good night.